Because one answer is you just work till you die, right? I mean, you just exhaust yourself, and well, that's not a good idea.
In this thought-provoking video, Jordan Peterson tackles the common and impactful issue of persistent fatigue. His insights are not just about managing tiredness, but about understanding the intricacies of our physical and mental states that contribute to these feelings. Through his wisdom, he presents practical advice and techniques that can help manage fatigue, enhance energy levels, and improve our overall sense of well-being. However, this is only the tip of the iceberg. Peterson's vast knowledge offers many additional strategies and solutions to improve our daily lives. His teachings continuously provide invaluable insights into the human condition and our capacity for resilience and growth.
And you can stack up all the money you want, you can stack up all the wealth you want. It is not going to protect you in the final analysis.
Peterson's commentary on handling tiredness serves as a crucial reminder of the importance of self-care and mindfulness. He brings to light the necessity of managing our energy effectively, maintaining a balanced lifestyle, and understanding our body's signals. His wisdom extends far beyond immediate solutions. It provides a foundation for long-term balance and well-being. Yet this is merely a stepping stone on the path of understanding he lays out for us. His teachings encompass a broad range of topics and provide a wealth of wisdom to guide us in navigating various aspects of our lives, far beyond managing fatigue.
You don't want to do so much work that the amount of work you do interferes with the amount of work that you could still do, right? Because if you work like mad for 2 weeks and then you have to lie in a hospital bed for a month, that obviously isn't very productive. So you have to figure out how much you can work diligently and then how much you have to recuperate so that you can get back up and work again. And you know, that's, people have basically settled on something like this and given it the divine imprimatur. That's one way of thinking about it, which is, well, you can toil away for 6 days and no wonder, because you have to work, but you should rest at least one day out of seven, because otherwise, well, you don't appreciate life. That might be part of it. And plus, I think it's more a matter of iterability, you know, because one of the things that defines morality is the capacity to repeat something.
Peterson always talks about the significance of mental resilience when grappling with feelings of exhaustion. He underscores the necessity of fostering a resilient mindset to overcome fatigue, to maintain productivity, and to just thrive in our daily lives. The power of the mind in dealing with physical challenges is a recurring theme in his teachings, and this video serves as a prime example of that. However, remember that this is only one facet of a multi-dimensional wisdom. There are countless more insights to glean from Peterson's teachings, each providing us a unique and valuable perspective on handling life's challenges and understanding ourselves better.
So if something is properly structured in a moral manner, then you can do it over and over and over again without any degeneration. And so that's kind of like a relationship. If your relationship is negotiated, you can continue to negotiate it, and then you can have a relationship that lasts for a long time. You can do it today and next week and next month and next year. You can maintain it across time. And this, I would say, is the wisdom that's been garnered over God only knows what period of time, to say, well, look, I mean, even God needed to take a break and appreciate what was going on. And it's not such a bad thing for people to follow that pattern. And that's a good thing for modern people to know, because we seem to be, even though, you know, we're very wealthy by historical standards, our capacity to relax isn't exactly what it could be, and I think that's really hard on people.
Peterson's perspective on managing fatigue also serves as a reminder that personal growth and development can occur through overcoming challenges. His advice on dealing with tiredness is not just about finding immediate relief, but also fostering long-term resilience and growth. He encourages us to view these tiredness periods as opportunities to understand ourselves better and to develop effective coping mechanisms. However, this is just the beginning. Peterson's understanding of human psychology and personal growth extends far beyond this specific issue, offering much more to learn and apply that can profoundly influence our approach to personal development.
I've worked with a lot of people who were hyper-conscientious, and the thing about hyper-conscientious people is that they'll just work till they die. And that's actually not very productive, because then they're dead and they can't work. And so what you have to do with hyper-conscientious people is you have to say, well, I know you'd rather do nothing but work, and maybe you're just as guilty as you can possibly be when you're not working, but let's figure out what you're up to. And what you're up to, in all probability, is the attempt to be productive in the least problematic, longest sustaining possible manner. And that might mean you have to take a rest. And so one of the things I used to work with lawyers, with people who had risen to the top of large law firms, and they were hyper-productive types. And they're often, you know, trying to hit their impossible quota for yearly hours. and burning themselves to a frazzle as a consequence. And one of the things that we used to do was they couldn't work fewer hours because that a day that just didn't work. But what we did was we'd have them take more time off, you know, like a four-day weekend every 2 months or something that was plotted out into the future. And then we'd track their billable hours, which is their degree of productivity, and it would actually increase. So that was so cool because you could take hardworking people and you could say, look, you know, take a break. Why? Well, because you'll be more productive if you take a break. No, that couldn't possibly be. Like, I should just work flat out all the time. It's like, let's test that out. You take a break now and then. It's like, well, what happened was their productivity would increase often by 10%. So there's wisdom here too, which is okay. And this alludes to the Adam and Eve story near the end. You're self-conscious. You discover the future. You have to work. Well, then the question is, how much should you work? And one answer is, you better bloody well work all the time, because no matter how much work you do, you're not solving your problems. They're coming along, man. And you can stack up all the money you want. You can stack up all the wealth you want. It is not going to protect you in the final analysis. So you better be hitting the ground running, and you better run flat out all the time. Well, what happens if you do that? Well, then you die. That's not a good solution. So maybe you should rest. And so how does that rest get instantiated? Well, it's not easy to tell, but one way to do it, let's say conceptually, is to say, look, even God had to rest one day a week. And so you don't have to be so presumptuous to assume that if God had to rest one day a week, that maybe, you know, you are allowed to work nonstop without a break at all. You know, and I think our culture has slipped into that in quite a dangerous way, because everything is open all the time. And I mean, I find that just as convenient as the rest of you. But, you know, it's so strange to talk to modern people, because one of the things they always tell you, we say, well, how are you? And what do they always say? They don't say good. They don't say bad. They say busy.
Peterson emphasizes the importance of maintaining a positive outlook when dealing with tiredness. His insights underscore the power of optimism and managing our energy levels and enhancing our overall well-being. He guides us towards adopting a positive mindset, not just as a means to combat fatigue, but as a fundamental approach to life. However, this is only a glimpse into Peterson's expansive world of wisdom. His teachings, filled with guidance on resilience, perseverance, and personal development, consistently offer unique perspectives on navigating life's ups and life's downs, providing us with the tools that we need to thrive.
How hard should you work? Well, that's a really difficult question. If you're going to die tomorrow, and then you probably shouldn't work very hard today at all. So one thing you might say is that the degree to which you should work hard is dependent on your assumptions about the stability of the future. We actually know this to be true, because if you put people in wildly uncertain circumstances, they discount the future, which is exactly what you should do, right? It only makes sense to store up goods for future consumption if the future is likely to be very similar to the past and the present. You need a stable society for that. And conscientiousness only works in a stable society, because all you do otherwise, if you're piling up goods, which is kind of what conscientious people do, is leaving them there for the criminals to take, or waiting for the next chaotic upheaval to wipe out everything that you've stored. And so even conscientiousness is a kind of guess. Hardworking people say, well, you know, sacrifice the present for the future. That's great, as long as the future is going to be there and you can predict it. But if it's not going to be there and it's unpredictable, then the right response is take what you can take right now while the getting's good. Now, you know, obviously there are troubles with that too, and I'm speaking, you know, I'm offering rough rules of thumb, but I'm trying to provide you with some indication of how and why these differences in value structures exist, because they're applicable in different environments. You know, sometimes in a dangerous social environment, it's not obvious that being an extroverted person is a good idea, because extroverted people, they stand out, especially if they're extroverted and creative, right? Because not only are they noisy and dominant and assertive, they're also colorful and flamboyant and provocative. Well, that's great if you're in a society that rewards that sort of thing, but if you have, you know, if you're ruled by an authoritarian king who wants absolutely no threat whatsoever to his stability ever, then dressing in gray and shutting the hell up is a really good survival tactic. So the utility of the trait depends on the structure of the environment that surrounds it. And that's why there's variability in traits. And so you have to be careful when you're thinking about it from a strict scientific perspective, to make the assumption that positioning at any place on the normal distribution is preferable to positioning anywhere else. Now, one exception to that maybe might be IQ. Because one of the things that you can see in IQ, with IQ, is that people with higher IQs seem to do better, but that's also only true in complex societies. And then there's another problem that seems to emerge with IQ, and I don't know exactly what to make of this, but we know that as women's IQ increases, the probability that they're going to be to remain without a mate also increases, because women tend to mate across or up dominance hierarchies. And so if you're a woman with an IQ of 130, then you've already eliminated about 95% of the men. And that's only using one criteria, that's just straight intelligence. And so there also might be limitations to the utility of intelligence with regards to reproduction that we don't really understand very well yet.
If you concentrate solely on your career, you can get a long way in your career. And I would say that that's a strategy that a minority of men preferentially do. That's all they do. They work like 70, 80 hours a week. They go flat out on their career. They're staking everything on the small probability of exceptional status in a narrow domain. But it's hard on them. They don't have a life. It's very difficult for them to have a family. They don't know how to take any leisure activity. Like, they get very one-dimensional. Now, it may be that that unidimensionality is the price you have to pay to be exceptional at one thing, right? Because if you're going to be something like a genius level mathematician, and you want to do that for, or a scientist, say, it's like you're in your lab all the time, you're working 70 hours a week or 80 hours a week, you're smart, you're dedicated, you're unidimensional, and that's how you get to beat all the other people who are doing that. It's the only way. But the problem is, you don't get a life. Now, if you love being a scientist and you have that kind of focus of mind, well, first of all, you're a rare person, and second, you're going to pay for it. But fine, more power to you. But it's a risky business to do that. You sacrifice a lot for it. You know, and I would say most often, if you're speaking about having a healthy life, that isn't what you do. You spread yourself out more. So, you know, you have a family, you have some things that you do outside of work that are meaningful to you and useful. You have a network of friends. Those three things alone, or four things alone, are plenty to keep you well oriented. And then if one of those things collapses, you know, everything doesn't go. Now, the price you pay for that is the more you strive to optimize that balance, the less likely you are to be fantastically successful at any single one of them. But you might have a very, you know, if you consider your life as a whole, that might be a winning strategy. One of the things Carl Jung said, I really liked this. He thought that men went after perfection and women went after wholeness. So they're different. There's something different at the top of the value hierarchy. So perfection would be stake it all on one thing and look for radical success. Not that all men do that, because they don't, but we're talking about extremes, at least with regards to the men that do that. The wholeness idea is more like, well, I want one thing in my life to be 150%, or I want five things in my life to be 80%. There's a lot more richness in a life where you have five things operating at 80%, but you're not operating at any of them at 150%. So, and I really believe this, because I've watched men and women go through their careers now for a long period of time, and there's lots of things that produce this. But one of the things that I've noticed is that mostly women in their 30s bail out of unidimensional careers. They won't do them. They won't put in the 80 hours a week that they would have to put in order to dominate that particular area. And it isn't, the reason that they won't do it is because they decide it's not worth it. And no wonder, because why would that be worth it? You have to ask yourself that. It's like, well, you want to be an outstanding scientist. It's like, okay, really? Really, that's what you want? Because that means that's what you do. Because you're competing with other people, you know, they're smart, they're hardworking, and if you want to be at the top, you have to be smarter and work harder than any of them. And working hard means working long hours. I mean, it also means working diligently, but in the final analysis, it's also an additive issue. If I'm smart and hardworking and I can crank out for 70 hours a week, and you do it for 30, it's like, in 2 years, I'm so far ahead of you, you will never ever catch up. So, anyways,
And I think partly, maybe part of the reason too, that women are oriented that way more than men, I think there's two reasons. Is one is socioeconomic status does not make women more attractive on the mating market, but it does make men more attractive. And the second is women's time frame is compressed, right? Because guys can always say, well, I'll have kids later. And they can say that till they're like 80. Whereas women, it's like, no way, man, you got to get it together by the time you're, let's say, 40, but really probably by 35, but definitely by 40, because otherwise it ain't happening. And that's bloody dreadful. Like, one of the common routes to extreme unhappiness is to want children and not have them. I wouldn't recommend that. You know, you see couples who are in their 30s. One couple in three over the age of 30 has fertility problems. That's defined as inability to conceive after 1 year of trying. One in three. That's worth thinking about, because people are very, very unhappy if they want to have kids and then they can't. Man, you're in the medical mill for 10 years if that's what happens to you.